On August 15, 1977, the Ohio State University's Big Ear radio telescope famously picked up what became known as the Wow Signal, due to scientist Jerry Ehman, a guest I interviewed at Event Horizon, link in the description below, writing on the computer printout the iconic word Wow. Because this was not an ordinary signal, but an extremely powerful signal in a protected area of the radio spectrum, set aside by International Agreement for Radio Astronomy, that was narrowband and looked technological, but for reasons I'll explain, didn't appear to be of human origin. The mystery over this signal's longevity is due to the circumstances and data involved with it. So the vast majority of signals that nature produces are broadband. This simply means that you will hear that signal at a bunch of different frequencies smeared across the radio dial. Because nature, when it emits radio, it only very rarely just focuses on a specific narrow frequency. Rather, it's a mess that's smeared all over the place. Only in very, very few circumstances can nature produce a confined, very narrow signal on the dial that you'll only see in one specific spot. But under very specific conditions, it can do it. More on that in a bit. I've spoken many times on this specific spot on the dial, 1420 megahertz, or the 21 centimeter hydrogen line, because it's important in radio astronomy for a huge reason. And that reason is hydrogen. Cold hydrogen clouds in the universe naturally emit radio at 1420, and due largely to the movement of those clouds, it red and blue shifts around, making it overall broadband on the dial, even though hydrogen in lab conditions does emit narrowband. The idea is that out of the billions of possible frequencies on the radio spectrum, aliens would locate a contact signal at or near this point, assuming that if you can build a radio telescope, you know that 1420 is a signpost frequency visible to all scientific civilizations in the universe. After all, hydrogen is the most common element in the universe and it naturally emits radio. The main argument against the Wow signal, however, is that it was unnaturally strong, 30 sigma above background. So whatever it was either close or it was from an extraordinarily powerful transmitter. That naturally led to the suggestion that it might have been interference from a clandestine spy satellite not listed in the normal registers. But there are problems with this. The first is that the signal over the 72 seconds it was observed did not move. It appeared to be fixed in the sky, something you want with a SETI signal, but not so common from a satellite. Another is that the signal contained no modulation, it was blank. Any video that shows audible representations of Wow, claiming that there was some kind of information or pattern there, is a hoax. This was just raw, consistent radio energy with no deviation of any detectable kind, and it wasn't recorded on audio equipment. It's numbers on a computer printout depicting signal strength. That's it. But there is enough there to glean some things. So the signal was fixed, eliminating planes and most satellites. But the scientists involved, Krauss, Ehman, and Dixon, were able to determine that the signal fit the antenna pattern of the radio telescope. This eliminates most possible Earth interference in 1977. And would restrict Wow to having originated at least one half of the distance to the moon. Add that with international agreements on leaving that frequency range open for radio astronomy, and you have the sticky issue that if you put a super secret satellite transmitting on those frequencies, every radio astronomer on planet Earth will pick it up with Earth's most sensitive radio receiving equipment, not good for hiding, and the world's militaries know it. Another more recent hypothesis was that the signal could have been due to comets that were in the general area at the time, and comets can emit relatively cold hydrogen. This hypothesis, while it got a lot of media attention, was sort of a non-starter, because if comets did this, then radio astronomers would have seen it 100 or more years ago. It would be that obvious, and it would also require a whole lot of hydrogen to make a signal like Wow, and comets just do not have it. Comets do not emit radio of this magnitude, again, 30 sigma. In astronomy, a reliable detection is 3 sigma. This was a whopper. The other issue being a double-edged sword. Only one feed horn of the pair picking up the telescope's signals caught Wow. The other did not, and had it been comets, they both would have seen it. Comets do not move fast enough to have moved out of the way. But if it were an alien signal, it turned off or on in a matter of less than 90 seconds. So Wow managed to escape all mundane explanations for it and has remained on the books since its discovery as something that may have been an artificial signal of alien origin. But that was only because no one had found a reasonable explanation otherwise for it. Because again, nature does not like to produce narrowband signals, though it can. What does like to produce narrowband signals is technology, because it saves energy. You transmit a signal at one frequency, everyone knows to tune in there, and you don't need to blast frivolous signals out on surrounding frequencies and waste energy. But there is one aspect of the Wow signal that you won't hear too often in the media or in YouTube videos, because it is a very little known fact buried in the literature. So the signal was just slightly above the hydrogen line. The reason for this was unknown, because it could have been transmitted there intentionally, or the other possibility is more interesting, that it was blue shifted ever so slightly. What blue shifting would mean is that the source of the signal was very slowly moving towards us. Very slowly as in slower than Voyager 2 is moving. Fast by the standards of our vehicles, but glacial as far as the universe is concerned. What was interesting, and this is key information right now, that blue shift precisely matched the blue shift of the hydrogen clouds in the Milky Way in that area. In short, it looked something like an extremely amplified version of the normal radio emissions of that part of the sky, roughly located in the constellation Sagittarius from our viewpoint. The thing is, hydrogen clouds were not thought to be able to amplify like that. We look at them all the time and they don't do it. And there didn't seem to be a ready physical way for it to happen. But it did lead to another hypothesis, that of interstellar scintillation. So this idea is dead. But the concept was that the interstellar medium actually isn't empty. There are hydrogen atoms and such floating around. And if those atoms somehow aligned, sort of like the atmosphere of the Earth causing stars to appear to twinkle, it could momentarily amplify a much weaker background signal for a very brief time. This also involved aliens, however. They would have just been extremely far away across the galaxy, which is why we normally cannot see them. Subsequent work, however, has ruled this possibility out as unbelievably unlikely. You'd need too many things to happen in the interstellar medium at once for it to work. But now, and I announce this with a certain amount of satisfaction, I wasn't certain this question one way or another would ever be answered in a compelling way. We may now know what actually caused the Wow signal. Finally, we have a compelling natural explanation. It wasn't aliens. Rather, it was a matter of the Big Ear telescope just happening to randomly catch an extraordinarily rare apocalyptic astrophysical event that we may not see again for centuries. Wow, indeed. This means that if Wow wasn't aliens, it was still a legitimate signal. The scientists that found it were not wrong in any way. It was not Earth interference or spurious comets. It was something they just didn't know at the time could happen. In short, even though it might not have been aliens, we still learned something here from the science done half a century ago, and we would have not been able to figure this out until the very most modern period of astronomical knowledge. This might not have been possible just a few years ago. This new research comes from the Planetary Habitability Laboratory at the University of Puerto Rico at Arecibo. Yes, they are still active and going, even though we lost the main Arecibo telescope to a structural collapse. They have other telescopes and archived data, and their work continues, led by another Event Horizon guest, Professor Abel Mendez. And yes, he will be on this Thursday to tell us about this work. The new research came out of a project to search archived data from the Arecibo Radio Observatory for other Wow-like signals. Link to the project's website also in the description for more information. The observations were taken with the now destroyed 305-meter telescope from 2017 to 2020, at frequencies not just at 1420, though that was included, but from 1 to 10 gigahertz. A further search was done last year with a 12-meter telescope, which focused on nearby red dwarfs at 8 gigahertz. And they found WOW-like signals near 1420 that looked exactly like WOW, but were nowhere near as strong. Again, signal strength was an outstanding feature of the WOW signal, but that work did yield some clues. So here's the scenario. It appears that a transient radio source, in this case, good candidates would be a magnetar flaring, or even a soft gamma-ray repeater, either way, some flavor of neutron star, and possibly even a neutron star with an ancient, fossilized, for lack of a better term, debris disk. Either way, it suddenly flares in the radio spectrum. And it turns out that this, if in the right proximity to a cold hydrogen cloud, basically the background, can momentarily and very suddenly cause it to brighten due to stimulation from the source. This would explain the correlation between the blue shift of the WOW signal and the local hydrogen clouds, and also solve the question as to whether it actually was blue shift that was observed. In this case, it was. A way to visualize this, and this is an oversimplification, but it gets the point across, is to imagine a thunderstorm passing overhead at night. You can see the clouds, but not in any detail. And then a lightning bolt moves through the cloud, and there it is, but only for a fleeting moment, and then you're back to waiting for another lightning bolt, and you have no idea when that will be. That's something like what we're looking at, and indeed, if this is indeed the explanation for the WOW signal, then we just happen to be poised for a really good view of an interstellar lightning show of sorts in the radio spectrum. There is something poetic about that, I think. So this new hypothesis, as far as I can tell, ticks all the boxes for the WOW signal. It was indeed further than half the distance to the moon. It was not interference. It was fixed in the sky. It appeared in only one feed horn because it was a relatively short flash. It was a real signal, and that leaves the question of why it was narrowband. And this hypothesis explains that too. Here's how. One way that nature can produce a narrowband signal is something called a maser. An astrophysical maser is a wide term in that it can be produced by everything from planetary atmospheres to molecular clouds, and they can be astonishingly narrowband, like a form of natural laser. It's not hard to imagine that the magnetic environment of a magnetar might produce one, or stimulate one in a hydrogen cloud, especially if that particular cloud is fairly small, because smaller clouds can be more cohesive and narrowband in their emissions. The narrowband aspect in this context is no longer very compelling evidence to point towards an alien origin for WOW. And it also is not at all surprising that WOW never repeated. This type of phenomenon is going to be very transient, and unless you're looking at the same patch of sky constantly for conceivably centuries, you may not see this event again. And if the hydrogen moves the wrong way, maybe never again. This explanation even covers how it could appear near the hydrogen line. I know, we all want evidence of aliens, but we must be absolutely sure, and we never were with WOW, and it did not seem like we would ever see a compelling resolution as to what it was. We seem to have that now. Though knowing the history of the WOW signal, I would not be surprised if someone comes up with an argument against it, and the mystery may continue. And if it repeats, aliens are back on the table. Where this is useful, however, is in further SETI searches. The SETI astronomers until now had no idea this could happen, and it now provides an entirely brand new way to weed out false positives, which in turn raises our chances of recognizing an actual alien signal should we ever see one. So there you have it. After all this time, we have the first compelling natural hypothesis to explain the WOW signal, and it only took 5 decades. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently informing you that Anna turned me loose again, and I have recently appeared on yet another podcast. This one hosted by Luke Lockhart, link in the description below, where we talked about aliens, multiverses, and all manner of space-related things. And yes, this one has video, which as you can tell from my channels, I previously had no idea was even possible. Computers are amazing. And now back to being a disembodied voice. And be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.